Hey guys, welcome back to my channel. I hope that everyone's having an awesome day. And today we are doing another soft-spoken reading video. Today we're reading chapters 11 and 12. If you like this video, please like it and subscribe. And let's just get started. Chapter 11. Holding tight to an anchor chain, I struggled to attach it to a spike embedded deep in the seafloor. The PV's house had inflated quickly once Pa turned on the pressurized air pumps. Nearby, Gemma gamely held on to her chain, even though she was floating on her tiptoes. I hid my smile as I watched her collapse into a muck to keep her arm to show her that I'd secured the end of her chain. Releasing it, she cheered silently as her section of the house arose into the place good as new. The dark interior of the PV zone was another story. In the few hours the house had lain on the seafloor, small creatures had found their way inside. Now crabs cuddled underfoot, illuminated by the strips of emergency lights embedded in the floor. Small fish darted cry, so he ran to it. Tenderly, she gathered up the mollusk and then scowled at Gemma. You could have hurt him. Hurt him, Gemma sputtered. That's not Rig with eyeballs grabbed me. In unison, Hewitt and I sucked in air. Slowly, furiously, so he got to her feet, still cradling the octopus. No, I yelled, stowing Gemma behind me. Hewitt scrambled on top of the kitchen table. Get out of the water. Zoe, calm down, I said, trying to sound reasonable in the face of my sister's rage. Gemma can't help it. She's a topsider. Gemma poked me in the back. She doesn't know how cool sea creatures are, I went on. It's not her fault. Zoe considered my words, and then after shooting Gemma a withering look, she stalked out of the kitchen with the octopus clinging to her like a baby. I relaxed a fraction. Still standing on the table, Hewitt glared at Gemma. Are you crazy? Never make Zoe mad. Ever. What is it with you two? Gemma asked. Zoe doesn't fight fair, I muttered. Please, she said with a snort. Last year, I lived in a dorm with over 100 teenage girls. The tears alone rivaled the rising. Never mind the fights. I think I can handle 1 9-year-old. You're tough, I know. I exchanged a look with Hewitt, who clearly had the same thought in his mind. In a tangle with Zoe, tough didn't matter. We retreated to the damp living room, where we pulled chairs around a portable heater, trying to stay warm while ignoring the constant dripping. I don't know why she's bothering to save the plants in the greenhouse, Hewitt muttered. We should just move topside. Zoe joined us, still holding the octopus, though she transferred it to a water-filled vase. She scowled at Gemma, who was rubbing her hands together over the squat heater. Hewitt cast another disgruntled look at the stairs that Cheryl had just descended, carrying rods for propping up plants in the greenhouse. Your parents are going to move over a little house sinking, I said, dropping into the chair next to Gemma. The sea blight gleaning attacked us. Are they called the sea blight game because they're a blight in the sea? Gemma asked. Yes, Hewitt said, and then paused. What's blight? Actually, Doc set down a bucket of rags as he entered the living room. They escaped from a prison named Sea Blight. I looked up with surprise. Where'd you hear that? I was working for the Department of New Solutions at the time. We were trying to solve the housing problem. This was before my professional reputation got put through a meat grinder. He said it lightly, but his smile was strained. My job was to monitor the health of anyone living in experimental housing. This happened in Sea Blight. He held up his palms, each marred with a slash of a scar, by way of an inmate's knife. So he hopped up for a closer look. I stayed put. Years ago, Doc had told me how he'd gotten his scars and that he couldn't perform surgery anymore because of all the tendons had been severed. But he never mentioned the prison's name. Representative Tupper is pressuring us to catch escaped convicts, I asked. Disbelief and disgust churned in my stomach. And not just any convicts. Doc pulled up a chair. These men are so dangerous and damaged, they were locked up in an experimental prison. Experimental? Gemma asked. Sea Blight was the first and only subsea prison ever built, Doc said, then turned to me. You've probably piloted over it 1,000 times. What? I asked. Where is it? Between here and the trade station. It's the building that used to house a science lab. At least that's what the public was told. The one marked structurally unsound, I asked. The squat two-story building was so nondescript, I never paid it much attention. That's the one, Doc confirmed. My indignation flared. Why'd the wealth call it a science lab? Doc raised an eyebrow. What do you think the settlers would have done if they'd known the government had built a maximum security prison within territory boundaries? question was ironic, but I answered anyway. They would have protested. Why did government deception still surprise me? Time to go, Buck called from the doorway. Wait, Zoe cried. I want to hear about the breakout. What breakout? Shirl asked, coming up beside Pa, carrying a potted tomato plant. The Z-Blood Gang isn't just a bunch of outlaws, Hewitt told her. Doc said they're escaped psychos and that we're not safe down. How'd they do it, Doc? I asked, interrupting Hewitt. Escape. Exactly 20 minutes later. Their eyes opened in unison. They didn't even realize the prisoners were gone at first. The door in the main holding cell was still sealed, and there were two more locked doors after that, not scuffed in any way. Everyone leaned forward, listening intently, our faces glowing with the orange light. And the surveillance cameras. That was strange, Doc said softly. The cameras were static for exactly 20 minutes, then resumed filming again as if nothing had happened. Cheryl looked shaken. This is just a spooky story, right, Doc? To scare the kids. It's all true. He held up a scarred palm as if taking an oath. 5 years ago, the Z-Blood Gang vanished from behind bars, and no one has ever figured out how they did it. Gemma's eyes lit up. Maybe one of them has a dark gift. Or they all do. They were living underwater, right? I've considered it, Doc told Gemma. Maybe during their time subsea they developed unknown abilities. Pa stood, annoyed. Stories like that start rumors. If they were in prison, they were adults, I said. That stupid theory only applies to kids. What if it isn't just a theory? Doc asked. No one has ever come up with a better explanation for how the outlaws escaped. He focused on Zoe. How about you, Angel? Got a special trick to show us? To my horror, Zoe slid her gaze to me as if asking for my permission. Of course, everyone followed her look. Forget what I've been saying, Shrimp. I kept my tone light, though. I wanted to strangle her. You have a real special gift. No reason to keep it a secret. Hewitt's mouth fell open. Really? Zoe asked. Sure, he said. Why not? Show them what you can do. But don't blame me when everyone starts screaming. For once in her life, Zoe squirmed as all the attention was directed at her. What can she do? Doc stepped forward. I shrugged. Not many people know that she can. Pick her nose with her tongue. Hewitt and Gemma yelled while Pa laughed outright. See, I told you no one wanted to know about it. I pinned my sister with a hard look. Some abilities you keep to yourself. Doc was the only one who hadn't recoiled. He was studying Zoe thoughtfully. Too thoughtfully. I caught her attention and tipped my head fractionally toward Doc. She bathed in a smile, oozing innocence as she stuck out her unusually long tongue and touched it to the tip of her nose. A chorus of don't, stop, and no rang out from around the circle. Doc settled back with a forced smile. 20 minutes later, suited in my dive skin and helmet, I swam to a feeding station under one of the PV's outbuildings. Everyone else sat on the cruiser, which hovered over the kelp. I dumped the bag of unusable food we'd pulled from the kitchen into the mesh-topped bin. Sadly, the babies had no fish left to feed, but the crabs would eat it. They'd eat anything. As I struck back toward the cruiser, I saw Gemma peering out the rear viewpoint. Spot outlaw's back. A mysterious shape drifted closer. It was a sub, all right, but not nearly big enough to be the specter. Like a shadow, the sub slipped sideways over the field, caught in a current, gliding haphazardly. If I wondered where the outlaws had hauled the abandoned bloody sub, I now had my answer.
Conversation.
That's the kid the top sellers wrote about, right? He asked, plucking his pillow, no doubt to avoid meeting my eyes. The one with the biosonar. I thought you were tired, I said to him. What's biosonar? Gemma asked. Same thing as sonar. Hewitt shimmied into his sleeping bag. Only it's an animal sending out the signals. Not a machine. She frowned. What signal? I dimmed the room light. It's getting late. After a loud yawn, Hewitt mumbled his reply. The clicking noise dolphins and whales make. Yes, that's what Akai does. Then he listens for the echoes in his brain, somehow turns them into pictures. She slid off the bed. So do you know him? No, he lay back in his sleeping bag. You know, I said gruffly. The doctor who wrote the article admitted that he never actually examined or even met a kid named Akai. He based his old dark gift theory on old case notes. He studied other kids, she countered. An outright lie. He said he did research on teenage boys down here, but 4 years ago. Stupid article came out. There weren't any teenagers in Benthic territory. Can we talk somewhere else? Gemma strolled over to me. Alone, she added softly. Uncomfortable, I ran a hand over the back of my neck. The way Pa did when he wanted to think about his answer. How many more questions could she have about Akai and dark gifts? Sure, I said finally. Her expression turned indignant. Though I couldn't begin to guess what I'd done wrong this time. It sure took you long enough to decide, Hewitt piped in. Was that it? Not because of you, I told Gemma. I don't mind being alone with you. Never mind, forget I asked. She turned to leave. I caught up and barred the door with my arm. I had to think of somewhere we can go. Quietly, I led Gemma past the kitchen. I heard my parents talking softly in the living room. All that separated us from them was the opaque wall of the stairwell. Before I could even make out Ma's words, her tone had told me she was riled up. I waved Gemma down the stairs ahead of me. The outlaws nearly killed Lars today. Ma kept her voice low, but it crackled with anger. I didn't have to peer around the corner to know that her hands were on her hips and her eyes were shooting sparks. Who knows what happened inside that derelict sub? The territory isn't safe anymore, and you know it, John. Gemma descended halfway down the stairs, then noticed I hadn't followed. I needed to hear Pa's reply. It was never safe, Carolyn. He said, sounding weary. But what's worse, living with the threat of danger, living safe and secure with no land to call our own? Is that what you want for our kids? To be hemmed in by millions of other people without room to explore our dream? Our dream is failing, Ma said sharply. Instead of sellers, we get drunks and gamblers passing through, and outlaws who steal from hardworking folk. She grew angrier with each word. What if Ty had gotten trapped inside the house when it collapsed today? I gritted my teeth. Was she going to realize I wasn't a little kid anymore? I could swim better than both of them and sense danger faster. And I sure as heck would judge when a house was about to cave in. Subsea houses don't come down that fast, Pa replied. There's always time to get out. Ma made an exasperated noise while Gemma's beckoning grew more insistent. I considered bursting into the living room and offering to scrape scum off the house for the next decade if my parents would just get off this topic. I don't want to raise my children in a place where there's no doctor, Ma whispered fiercely. Not when Ty ignores her rules and takes more risks every day, like exploring derelict subs. I winced. I should have known she wasn't going to let that misdeed slide by. Oblivious to the hushed argument in the next room, Gemma headed back up the steps. As she passed me, I caught her hand and pressed a finger to her lips. "So that's it," Pa snapped. "You want to abandon everything we've worked for? Give up?" I waited for Ma's reply, but when her footsteps clipped halfway across the living room, I realized she wasn't going to answer him. She was walking away from the argument, heading directly for us. Dragging Gemma halfway down the stairs, I pressed his belt to the wall. Ma stormed past the stairwell without looking down. I relaxed, only to realize I'd flattened Gemma against the wall with an arm across her chest. "Sorry," I whispered, releasing her. She hurried down the stairs. This time I followed her, Ma's comment about ignoring rules ringing in my ears. As soon as I closed the greenhouse door behind us, Gemma asked, "Will you help me sneak into the saloon? I want to see if my brother is there." "What? No," I sputtered. "Did you hear anything my mother just said? If I break another rule, she's hauling her whole family topside." "At least you'd be together." "Yeah, all crammed into one room. Sounds like heaven." Gemma's brows drew together. "I can't even remember my parents, and I haven't seen my brother in 3 years. If we could all live together, I wouldn't care if we lived in a closet." She marched past me and disappeared in the foliage. Okay, now I felt like total chum. "You'll get kicked out of the saloon faster than a cart shark can shuffle." I pushed through the stalks of corn to find her. "No one will let you step off the elevator unless you're 18. She stopped shoving through the plants. "Not 21. Like I said, you can start a homestead at 18. They consider you an adult then." "I look 18. "Yeah, and I don't know how to swim. I bet you could get me in." "No," I said firmly. She didn't know what she was asking. She hadn't seen the knife fights I'd witnessed on the surface deck alone. Gemma sat on a tank of filtered water by a large window. Apple trees ripe with fruit swayed overhead. "I didn't have permission to come to Benthic territory," she said. I wasn't surprised to hear it. Already I knew that Gemma wasn't the kind of girl who asked permission. "You ran away," I said. She nodded as she traced a starfish that was climbing the window. "The director, Miss Spinner, is probably bursting an artery right now." Gemma's smile was grim. "She wants a bigger apartment, but every time a kid goes missing from her boarding home, she gets dropped down the housing waiting list, which is really demeaning to an adult. Space being the ultimate status symbol. Anyway, I go missing a lot, so Miss Spinner's chances of moving get worse and worse. Most of the time I just sneak up to the tower roof. It's broiling hot and smells like tar, but it's the only place where I don't feel trapped." I understood what it meant to feel trapped. Only the whole topside made me feel that way. A sun-baked roof would be just another cranny in hell. Gemma met my eyes. Miss Spinner said if I disappeared again, she'd send me to a reformatory for juvenile delinquents. "Just for looking for your brother?" I asked skeptically. "She sent Richard away for less. All he did was sneak into a quality time room for after hours." "Oh, what? You sure don't know much about life above." She gave the ceiling a disparaging wave. "When parents come to see their kids, they rent a quality time room with couches and games and a kitchen. When I was younger, I'd spend every Saturday walking up and down the visitors' hall, peeking in the windows. I'd pretend I was shopping for a family." My throat constricted at the image of her alone in a corridor that rang with other people's talk and laughter. "Anyway," she went on, "sometimes late at night, Richard would pick the lock on one of the rooms and I'd meet him there. I was really little, but I always managed to sneak out of whatever dorm I was in. We'd eat together and he'd read to me, like other families. Then we'd clean up so no one would know we'd been there. Richard made that part fun, too. Why couldn't you meet in one of those rooms during the day?" "We didn't have money. That's why when we got caught, Miss Spinner called Richard a thief. He stole space. A serious offense. So she shipped him off to her reformatory and wanted to tell me which one." Gemma smiled at all when he came back. After 6 months, he took off, said he couldn't stand the crowds. I think that's why he ended up down here. She touched my arm. Ty, please, help me find him. How was I supposed